Remember back in the 90s when CDs were the big thing? Not so much in size, of course, but in popularity? Back then, to have a Discman was the big thing. And to have a good old monster with a CD player in your room? That was hot stuff too. Things change, and all things do. In 1999, of course, Napster was born, bringing a widespread attention to the MP3 file. With all this talk of iTunes mastering and which is left or wrong or right, I wanted to bring to you what I'm going to call the short and sweet trip through the Great Compression. So, let's get lost, or lossy. The MP3 format. We all know it. Some of us love it, and some of us hate it. But all of us have used it from time to time, and matter of fact, you're using it right now, so please don't shoot me. It was initially released in 1993, but got its main release and turned some heads in 1995, with its backward compatibilism to MP2. Too many letters and numbers, I realize. The first MP3 player? We've got a Walkman and a Discman. Why not an MPman? And of course the question being now, was it developed by Sony? Ah, we couldn't get that lucky. The MPman was developed by the Seihan Information Systems. Came in two models, 32 or 64 MB. How much did it sell for? The 32 megabyte, sold for $400. Yeah, you heard me right. Really makes me thankful for the term gigabyte and that it's gotten small enough to fit in my pocket. Napster, the word that brings loads of different emotions into minds of many. As a kid, I thought it was pretty dang cool, and I knew a lot of others that did as well. As a parent, the three letters MP3 seemed to raise red flags. As one of my friend's parents asked me, aren't those illegal? Napster was founded by a group of Seans and John. What I mean is, Sean and John Fanning and Sean Parker. The name was founded from Sean Fanning's favorite hairstyle. Imagine that. Napster's back-end system architecture was developed and designed by Jordan Mendelson, and it was a robust system, whose popularity generated a wealth of music to download. At its peak, there were 25 million users and 80 million songs. The system never once crashed. High-speed networks at college and dormitories became overloaded with over 60% usage in peer-to-peer downloads. It was huge. Of course, it had its ups and downs. Some users thought it legitimate to download cassette album purchases, while some just enjoyed sharing music. One of the big red flags, or attention getters, to the big labels was when the heavy metal band Metallica found that a pre-release of a track off their upcoming album, I Disappear, was circulating on Napster. It was also receiving radio airplay around the US. Interestingly enough, not even being a single. The illegal Napster was shut down for good in 2001. Of course, the big-time bands and labels were against Napster, but what about the little guys? Along with the accusations that Napster was hurting the record industry, there were those who felt just the opposite, that file trading on Napster actually stimulated, rather than hurt, sales. Some evidence may have come in July of 2000, when tracks from the English artist Radiohead's album Kid A found their way to Napster 3 months before the record's release. Unlike Madonna, Dr. Dre, or Metallica, Radiohead had never hit the top 20 in the US. Furthermore, Kid A was an experimental album without any singles, and received relatively little radio airplay. By the time of the record's release, the album was estimated to be downloaded by millions, for free of course, and in October 2000, Kid A captured the number one spot on the Billboard 200 chart on its debut week. According to Richard Binta of MP3 Newswire, the effect of Napster in this instance was isolated from other elements that could be credited for driving sales, and the album's unexpected success suggested that Napster was a good tool for the promotion of music. One of the most successful bands to owe its success to Napster was Dispatch. Interestingly enough, I remember these guys, and where did I hear them? From Napster, of course. Being an independent band, they had no formal promotion or radio play, yet they were able to tour cities they'd never been to and sell out concerts, thanks, of course, to the spread of their music on Napster. In July 2007, the band became the first ever to headline New York City's Madison Gardens, selling it out for 3 consecutive nights. The original Apple iPod was released in 2001 with the slogan, Apple Presents iPod, 1,000 songs in your pocket. The iTunes Music Store opened April 28th of 2003. In its first week, iTunes sold 1 million songs. And on February 24th, 2010, the Apple iTunes Store served its 10 billionth download. And when you do some quick math, this took place in just under 7 years of being online. Music in the iTunes Store is sold in the AAC format, which is the MPEG-4 specified successor to MP3. In 2007, the iTunes Store goes mobile on iPhone and iPod Touch. Of course, this allows anyone that has one of these devices to purchase and download songs anywhere they are, given that they have a Wi-Fi or 3G connection. To me, it's truly amazing. In the last 20 years, we've come a long way in regards to what we can do with technology. 20 years ago, in 1992, we were just getting used to CDs, at least most of us, hearing everything digitally remastered for the first time. None of that tape or vinyl hiss that we had been used to for so long. Skip back to reality. In today's world, though everyone's pretty much used to a digital music scene, people are used to hearing music in a lossy format rather than hearing music in a lossless one. So there we have it, the trip through the Great Compression. Wonder where we'll be in the next 20 years. All information for this audio production was found at wikipedia.org.